a privilege to be invited to kind of moderate this panel, because it's also the first time that the Gilders Collective is having a discussion together. So, you know, feel free to ask questions if you feel like in the middle of the discussion. It's fairly informal, though there will be a question answer round at the end. Just so that we're not strangers in a room, I'm going to do a few brief introductions. I'm Pia Singh. I'm based in Chicago now for the last 5 years, and I'm originally from Bombay. I'm a curator and a director of a small non-for-profit which focuses on Indian art and culture. Some of the people in the room, I'm going to start with Kelsey on my right and Andrew at the far right. Who are together partners in life and in work. They're sign painters based in Chicago who specialize in gold leaf signs under the name Heart and Bone Designs. I'm just gonna read a bit if that's okay. They follow the Chicago tradition that was taught to them by their mentor, who's also here with us right next to Kelsey, is Robert Frese. Is that correct? Frese? Who has been making gold leaf signs in Chicago for over 30 years. With an emphasis on hand lettering, they've been collaboratively producing signs in the United States since 2011. And as sign artists, they're interested in promoting the craft of hand-painted and gold leaf signs. They're interested in providing opportunities for small businesses to have distinctive sign identities and signs that can stand the test of time. And in 2018, interestingly, they opened a dedicated gallery space called Electro Pepper, which highlights the work of sign painters and other labor-based art forms around the world. To Kelsey's right is Robert. Hi. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
The gold father. I have to say it twice, gold father. That's so good. Began the study of traditional sign painting in his hometown of Long Beach, California. He was an apprentice for 8 years at the Hardy Sign Company, and he was attracted at the time to the artistry of the past and the beautiful gold leaf signage he saw, which is what led to him moving to Chicago in 1984. At the time, you worked for F.O. Carlson and Company, and it was here that he learned to work with gold leaf. After a few years, he developed enough confidence to work on his own. So in 1986, Robert started the Chicago Gold Sign Company, which has been around for the last 30 years, which is which is when you decided to dedicate your career to mastering the art of gilding and sign design. His work can be seen adorning historic buildings, retail, and hospitality businesses throughout Chicago. To Robert's right is Shan. Hello.
Hello.
Who for the past 40 years, is this a game? Like, who withstands the longest time? That's a long time. For the last 40 years, Shan, and it doesn't show at all.
I'm 57. I started when I was 17, so.
For the past 40 years, Sean's career has run the gamut of sign painting, cabinet making, graphic design, and stained glass. He founded Illumination Art and Design in 2001, which specializes in historic painting technique. Glass is your canvas.
Yes.
Glass is your canvas, and you currently work with gold leaf.
Verre aglomigé.
Aglomigé. What does aglomigé mean?
It's basically the art of back painting glass with you scratch through and you create designs and shapes and illustrations and stuff.
So verre aglomigé mirror art, glass etching, and vitreous painting for illustrative leaded glass. Felix believes the opulence of the past serves as a memory fragment for a new contemporary viewpoint, a celebration of handmade workmanship that crosses borders, ages, and cultures. That's quite beautiful. So now that we have a bit of history on each of us, maybe we can move towards the history of gilding in Chicago. And for that, I'm kind of going to ask Robert to walk us through an initial introduction, and then we kind of take it from there.
Yes. I'll just hang
on. Testing.
Hello.
Yeah. So, yeah, my name is Robert Frese, AKA the Goldfather. That's kind of catchy. Anyway, basically the art of gilding, glass gilding especially, started probably here in Chicago, 1860s. And it had its heyday. The golden age of gilding was probably from 1860 to 1920. And in that 80-year span, you know, there was, it was prolific. Just about everybody had gold leaf. Gold was cheap, labor was cheap. It predated electrical signage, so to get somebody's attention, it had to be gold. And
I think one of my favorite stories when I was doing a bit of research before this talk was, you know, the whole idea of the medium being something that caught the eye of a viewer as they walked by, and we're talking about pre-electricity, right?
Correct.
Yeah. So correct.
Or the electrical signs.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Neon. You know, it predates neon and any type of electrical signage. They probably had gas. They had gas. They had gas lamps in the day. So, it was considered the ultimate, and still is the ultimate sign. You know, medium. And it's alive. It's constantly moving as as people walk by, the lighting. It's, to me, it's the most attractive, you know. I mean, look at the sign. I mean, it's always, you know, it gets your attention. And then in the 20s, it kind of, you know, went downhill because of the Depression, by the Depression years and stuff like that. And then after the wars, you know, it was a whole new era where, you know, gold leaf was pretty much obsolete in the day. But here in Chicago, there was three main companies that maintained the standard, especially for the historical buildings, and that was H.M. Witt, F.O. Carlson, who I worked for, and Marks and Company. And there was a few others, but those are probably the biggest players in the day. And they've really kept the gold leaf standard for all these years, even though it's waned and, you know, gotten popular. So. Then in the 1980s, mid-80s, there became a renaissance, and it started basically in Denver by these three guys, three main guys, but Rick Lawson, he was an excellent one. Rick Lawson was a big influence of mine, and he was like the leading restorer of reverse glass, and he's passed now, but...
When you say reverse glass, can you explain?
Reverse glass is, we actually gild everything on the back side of the glass versus the front side, and that's how you get the different reflections and mirror images. If you do it on the first surface, you're not going to get that. So it's everything is always done on the back side, so it's called reverse glass. Thank you for that.
And the trade, what
do you call it? The trade? Yeah, first surface, second surface, yeah, second surface. So, these young apprentices in Denver started researching and figuring out, hey, you know, looking at old manuals and things like that, because really the art was lost, and they brought it back. So it was sort of a renaissance in my generation. Looking at Rossin and Evans, and even things in Denver.
Yeah.
Even things in Denver. There was still, Denver was had a lot of gold in its day.
If you don't mind talking a little bit about Rossin and Evans.
Yeah.
This is a picture of a Chicago store.
Okay. So Rossin and Evans was here in Chicago, probably from the 1860s to the, I don't think it was the 60s, probably more like the 1880s to the 1920s. And they were huge. They employed probably over 100 people, and they were glass decorators. Then they would do coaches for railroad cars. They did office doors. They they discovered chipping and etching. They did acid etching, all these different processes on glass. And they did a lot of the reverse glass signs for insurance companies, for breweries was big. And they were on West Washington. They had a big factory over on West Washington.
You mentioned chipping and another technique.
Yeah, glue chipping is actually where you sandblast the surface first and then you apply a hide glue to it, and it, when it dries, it shrinks and it just basically fractures the surface of the glass and causes a fern, or, you know, organic fern pattern. And that's what you're looking at there on that background. And then when you silver it or gild it, it just sparkles. And then the other process is acid etching, which that is acid etched. And that's a hydrofluoric acid that is mixed with a mica sort of flake. And that's what gives it that pounded look, that, you know, gives it the dimension. Those are the three, you know, and then sandblasting, obviously, or just basic white, what is it, the one where you you etch just on a bit with acid alone?
Oh,
what do they call that?
White acid.
White acid, yeah, French acid, white acid. So all these different processes to decorate the glass. And Ross and Evans was, you know, a big, and they would, you know, with Chicago being the manufacturing town it was, they were close to the railroad, and they would ship their product all over the country, you know.
Keeping on that glue chipping for a moment, talk about how it was discovered on accident and about patent.
Well, that's, it's speculated that in the shop one day, they used to use hide glue to, in those days, to glue up frames, wood frames and things like that. It was a wood glue. It was made out of hide. And they had a piece of glass on a table that was etched, and some glue got spilled on it. And when it dried, it fractured the surface. And they're like, oh my God, this looks great, you know? So I think that's how they, so they actually had the patent on glue chipping for some years. So their competitors was Peapaws and Company. Do you have a picture of Peapaws? Peapaws was lesser known. But for some reason, I've done some restoration in the past, and it's always been Peapaws, and I actually own like three or four Peapaws pieces.
And they were in Chicago as well.
And they were also in Chicago.
And yeah. Rustin and Evans had another, they were based in Chicago and New York, is it?
Actually, they weren't based in New York. Okay. They had a showroom in New York.
I see, okay.
Yeah, all the manufacturing was here in Chicago, but they were that big where they actually had, what they called jobbers or something like that in New York, and they had a showroom. And then there was Western Sandblast, so there was three main players on that, and they were all Chicago-based.
And was there, like, cities with competing presence in the gilding community as compared to Chicago at the time?
There was other...
For the 20s right now.
Right. There was some other manufacturers. Like, there was this... Hot Dawes and Company out of somewhere in Pittsburgh or something like that. I'm not real familiar with them, but I did see some of their pieces, and they specialize in more of a slumped convex pieces.
Explain which, a little bit what slumped glass is.
So slumped glass, well, Sean actually should talk more about that because he's actually slumping. Did you slump those?
We got a real slumper.
We got a real slumper here. Yeah. No, you have the kiln.
Yeah, I just recently purchased a kiln. And slumping is when you take a flat piece of glass and you have a metal mold, and then you bring the glass up to temperature slowly, and the glass literally slumps down and conforms to the mold. So back in the old days, they actually had buildings with curved glass signs on the corners and things. That was a common thing, especially with banks. Mm-hmm. And Robert has an excellent example. Was that by Western Sandblast?
That's a
Ross and Evans piece.
I have an original Ross and Evans.
Yeah. And it's curved. The glass is, in addition to all the glue chipping and the gilding that's on it, the glass is actually curved as well, too. So we're trying to bring back these old school techniques, more or less.
Did I finish the questions on that?
I think you had said something about Pittsburgh and the presence of like other gilding, you know, communities, and the presence of gilding nationally. And maybe the reason I ask is because it sounds like Chicago was central.
Yeah, especially for the glass decorating side of it. Mm-hmm. Now there was, you know, as far as Gilders on site like we are, you know, there was all over any major city had, you know, really good craftsmen in the day. And they all came from basically Europe, England, Germany, you know, France. That's where the art came from, and it was brought over. So they were actually doing it earlier.
Right.
And then when, what? Oh, yeah. You can't hear me? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Amazing stuff. I lost my train of thought.
You were talking about how originally.
I'm a little nervous here.
There's no need. Everybody say.
I know.
Everybody say your name. No, but I think that's been extremely enriching in terms of painting a landscape and seeing how Chicago is, you know, central to the community, which is why here we are, you know, having this conversation. One of the things that I think both of you had mentioned when we were talking before the talk was that, you know, when you came to Chicago for the first time, you noticed this beautiful work walking by and just found it absolutely irresistible, needed to know more.
Yes.
And that's why I'm beginning to maybe think about, you know, how much of it do we see anymore and how do we begin to then address where it is now compared to what you were just talking about in the 20s. You know, historically, are there people who know where, like I wouldn't know where Rawson and Evans' office was.
Right.
Is that a site? Is there a way to, you know? So yeah, I think Kelsey wanted to just say something, so I'm gonna pass the mic.
Well, I think that's a really important point because that's kind of why we've come together, is that there is like this wealth of knowledge from our mentor and our peer Shan, who we just are fortunate to always have the experience of talking to, but to kind of make a point to the public that this is a part of Chicago history that is unrecognized and really to a certain extent kind of documented and archived. So for us, it's really a point to say, this is, I mean, this, the building is no longer there, but, and there are really no signs.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
There are no signs around, but there is still a living history that exists. And we're all a part of that. So,
I mean, just to reconstruct a glimpse of it, who were, for example, could you help us understand who were some of the people who would commission gilded signs back then versus the kind of people who you see now on the field?
Insurance companies, obviously. Breweries were big. They always, everybody advertised on glass in those days. It was pretty much mainstay, you know. You'd always see glass signs. A lot of it hasn't survived. Obviously, because it was glass, got destroyed. Those would be two big ones. What else? I mean, just any type of business, you know, would advertise.
Also bankers, lawyers.
Yeah, of course.
It was kind of a sign of status.
Right. Doctors, too. Yeah.
But it's changed quite a bit now.
Yeah. Banks were big, banks, you know, and now the modern bank is all modern and contemporary and, you know. Yeah, but banks always had gold leaf, you know, in the 50s, 40s.
I think it's really important.
There was a gentleman, Al Grand, who I got to meet before he passed, and he was from Detroit, and he was a gilder for 40 years plus, amazing guy, and got to meet him in the early letterheads. We used to have these organization called the Letterheads, which I kind of briefly mentioned, but he used to just travel the country doing banks, mostly banks, insurance companies and things like that, and made a living out of it, you know. But even by the 70s, the market changed for him, you know. And by the 80s.
Why was that?
just a trend, yeah. You know, the thing fell out of favor, you know, it's
vinyl.
Well, and then, neon. Yeah, the 80s, another revolution was in the late 70s, early 80s, we had the computer, the vinyl graphics came in, the plotter, the CAD/CAM machines. And it was, and I was just starting. I started in 76, and by, you know, early 80s, we found out about this machine. I'm like, what the hell did I even get into this job for? You know, I'm going to be taken over by a machine. Well, it obviously didn't happen, you know, totally, but, and now I embrace it. I use a computer, I use a plotter at times. I mean, it's another tool.
Yeah, I was going to get to that a little later once we, like, delve into. I think it's important to say, yes, there are the pros and cons of machines being sure. incorporated into craftsmanship today, but at the same time, also, like, one of the biggest questions, and especially where I'm from, you know, India is a craft-rich country, and
sure.
one of the biggest questions we face is, you know, what leads to the obsolescence of a craft, and, you know, the story kind of drops.
Right.
And it's all very abrupt when it happens, and then suddenly cut to 20 years later, and someone's like, where did it go?
Right, yeah. And then they want to, you know, revitalize it. There's a resurgence sometimes.
And often in those kind of countries, there's right. no record of it. It just vanishes.
Right.
But the good thing is, in this case, you know, you're talking about the 80s when the computer came and it
correct.
Started to, like,
correct.
You know, perform its own role in the process. But there is something special to be said about gold leaf gilding, where we're talking about human relationship between the mentor and the next generation of artists. And this is true to any craft. It's always, like, passed on firsthand stories, narratives, lived realities that kind of lead to the next generation of the, you know, craftsmen taking it forward. So in this case, I was wondering if maybe each of you could talk about your experiences in kind of being passed down knowledge. And then we could move forward to, like, next generation machines.
Because I am the pass down. But I think.
Let's start with Shan.
Okay.
And then she'll go, and then I'll go.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Go, Shan.
Okay.
Go, Shan. Go.
Okay. Well, I started around the same time Robert did, and I started as a hand lettering artist. And in the area that I was at, I wasn't in an urban area, I was in the suburbs, and gold leaf was almost gone then. I apprenticed with a sign painter whose father did gold leafing, and it's like, oh, I want to do this stuff, you know?
Was this in Frankfurt?
This was in Frankfurt, Illinois. Steger, Illinois, Chicago Heights, Illinois. That's my stomping grounds, more or less, you know. And I met Robert through Signcraft magazine, and I saw the work that he did, and I saw work that a lot of these Denver artists were doing and a lot of the California artists, and I was blown away. A lot of artists from England that were doing some phenomenal work, and it's like, this is what I wanted to learn how to do, you know. And I was kind of on my own. I was kind of isolated from, I didn't have any friends that did this. And it wasn't until I met Robert, and he kind of showed me the ropes on this. But I was in that same genre where the handcrafted signs was leaving and the vinyl was moving in. And I found that I had to adapt. And I started doing vinyl graphics and then digital illustration and things like that. I even got out of the sign business for a while and started pursuing stained glass and other things that so that I could keep my hand in things. Now I'm at the point now where there's a big resurgence of gold leaf signs, especially thanks to young people like Kelsey and Andrew, who are bringing a nice awareness of this through social media and things. That's something that me and Robert are, you know, we're dinosaurs when it comes.
No one says I met him through a magazine anymore.
What's that?
No. That's really well, special.
Yeah. Yeah. I met him through a magazine. You know, those kind of questionable magazines where they have little ads in the back. No. Hi, hot sign painter wanted.
That's really something. I mean, so you learned through Robert and
I learned through Robert, and then I kind of went off on my own and I added my own twist to
And you
it.
Mentioned a friend's father or someone. Like someone's father or something like that. Did you say that?
Father.
Sorry.
The first I worked with this, I could say this because he's dead. I worked with this crazy French guy named Vic Giroux, and he was an eccentric maniac. And his father was a gilder. And he was French Canadian from Vermont, and he came to Chicago for the, you know, a lot of the sign painters, they came to the cities because that's where the steady work was. When you lived out in the country or the suburbs, you had to travel to get to the work. And that kind of brings us to another point about what Robert was saying about how gold was in the cities, and it's something that you see, you know, you got to realize in the late 1800s, cities were for pedestrians. People walked amongst the shops and stuff. So there wasn't this need to have these giant signs, these giant electrical signs from all over the place, because cities were still a walking area. And when you walk in the city and you see yourself reflected in a gold leaf sign and you see the craftsmanship, I think that's why this is coming back in the cities, not so much in the suburbs or rural areas, you know.
A really good point. I'm glad you brought that up, because there's some things that we'll talk about later as well, culturally, about, you know,
sure,
just the pace of life and how things are seemingly changing in our generation. But
yes,
who knows? Who was next? I think it was Rob. Was it?
Oh, it was going to be Kelsey.
Kelsey?
I think
you should
go. What do you want me to say?
Who mentored you, and what was like the relevance?
Why am I passing my knowledge?
I mean, who mentored you, and how was that relationship vital to the craft? I think because that's right, something very specific to gold leaf gilding.
Well, my first mentorship was an apprenticeship at Hardy Sign Company in Long Beach. Actually, it was 6 years. It wasn't eight. And Hardy was another character, just like, you know, Giroux was.
Most of those guys were drunks.
Yeah, he was an alcoholic, but he was, you know, a great guy. And he was like a father figure to me. And he was a traditional sign painter, and he was second generation. His father was a sign painter, and he was also from Canada originally, and talked about his dad doing gold. And what we did is I learned the basics there. You know, we painted trucks, we painted walls, nothing, no gold leaf. And then I went to a wedding in 1983, to my cousin's wedding, and I came out to Chicago and I went downtown. I saw all the gold leaf windows. It was obvious there was more gold leaf windows downtown than there is now. I was like, I got the fever. I was like, I gotta do this, you know? So I had a one-way ticket, and the next year I came to Chicago with a one-way ticket, my sign kit, and my suitcase. And I got on a bus from O'Hare to downtown, and I stayed a week at the YMCA and got a job within a week at F.O. Carlson, and stayed there for 2 years and cut
Thank
my
you.
Teeth.
Yeah.
So,
how does it apply? Maybe you're going to get to that, but what's the technique to apply it?
Oh, yeah, we'll talk about that. No, yeah, we'll talk about
I
that.
I think we can, yeah, we'll talk about that in about 20 minutes.
Yeah,
we'll have a question answer where we can get really detailed about
the techniques,
about, like,
yeah.
Because, one of the things that we're also fortunate to have is a mentor and a student, you know, in the same panel. So I was hoping that Kelsey and Andrew could. Yeah. Go ahead.
So just to continue this, or, you know, wrap it up, my biggest influences actually were, well, Hardy, obviously, for basics. But when I came out to Chicago, I met there was a workshop by Noel Weber. And Noel Weber is an amazing guy, if anybody knows who he is. Or he's one of the guys that I've always looked up for. His craft is just number one. And he's one of the ones that started the whole letterhead movement, what we call the letterheads, which is an international organization of sign painters. And he was one of the original founders in Denver in like 19... I don't know, when did they start, like 79, 80, something like that. They started this little clique, just discovering old processes, and then it became an international organization. But I took his workshop. He came to Chicago, and he taught us how to chip and acid etch and blend and all these cool things and how to, you know, and that was a big influence. And then from that, that's segued into this Mr. Rick Lawson out of California, which is kind of ironic. I was born and raised in California, in Southern California, in Long Beach, and Rick was in Wilmington, which is the town right next door. And Rick was the leading guy on gilding, restoring antique glass signs like Rawson and Evans, Peepaws, and things like that. He was the guy. And so then I started going to his conclaves and workshops. And so those two were probably my biggest influence on learning how to gild and all the other processes. And then just, you know, doing your own thing and figuring it out. So... Yeah.
So you've passed on some of that experiential knowledge to Kelsey and Andrew.
You know, I mean, I'm not young anymore.
You're not?
No, not too young. And, you know, I only got a few more years left and I'm going to, you know, say bye. I'm going to go back to California,
you leave,
I think.
Before you leave, Andrew or Kelsey or both of you, tell us how instrumental he's been to your practice. I mean, you work together, so I'd be happy to have you.
I mean,
both
we speak for each other all the time, so this is nothing new.
We speak for each other, so.
Oh, that's the question. Kelsey and I have, the way that we got into lettering is different. We can leave that for another story, interesting in its own way, but we met Robert. We had moved out here from Denver to go to graduate school at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. We were accepted as a collaborative to the graduate program of painting and drawing, which was pretty cool because it was the first time that a collaborative had ever been accepted into that program. It's pretty neat. And we got done with it and realized that, you know what, I don't think fine art is really for us. We had already been doing some mural painting. We had been doing some, what we didn't even realize at the time, sign painting back in Denver. And then we had reached out to a mentor of ours, who I wish was here, Stephen Reynolds. Have another student of his right here, Stephen Monkmeyer, who's another very talented sign painter in the group here. So we learned the very basics, did everything the right way, didn't try to jump through any hoops or try any tricks, try to jump ahead or anything. Used the skills that we had from art school, moved our way through, started feeling confident in our ability to create traditionally crafted signage, and then were very curious about gold leaf. Kelsey had reached out to Robert, and then he graciously allowed us to come over to his home. We hit it off. Had a lot in common. We're all into music, into art, into painting. And it's not like he gave up everything easy. He was like, here's a little bit here. Let's see what you do with it. Let's see how you do. And we're like, okay, we're like feverishly taking notes and making sure we do it right. We come back, is this all right? It's like, yeah, that's all right. Come on back. We'll see how it goes. He's like, here's a bigger sprinkle. How do you do? I'm like, oh, okay. Let's see how it goes.
But you guys had the advantage of learning in a time when you had machines. You had computers and technology to kind of assist you versus maybe a time when, and I'm not saying anyone in this panel is off that time, but like a time when it was being passed on as a, you know, very physical, handmade, laborious, like everything from scratch versus like the assistance of any kind of.
That is very true.
Yeah.
One of the things that was very important to Kelsey and I from the get was when we started, we wanted to make sure that we were doing everything the very old school way. We weren't going to be using computers. We were going to be hand drawing our letters. We were going to be understanding how typography is formed, appropriate kerning, character length, like everything, old school. And we took that to heart for very many years, up until today. You know, when it comes to, we've been gilding for 7 years now, and when we get to do something that's really creative, and we get to draw everything by hand, like, we're not using masks, we're not using silk screens, we're pulling all the lines by hand, we're, you know, the entire pattern is drawn by hand, we're doing it old school. That being said, speaking of the machines, if we're doing cookie cutter, like Helvetica, I'm not gonna kill myself, like outlining all of that for no reason. I'm gonna cut a mask for that, line it, pull it, gild it, get the job done, and on to the next one.
So is that, Kelsey, do you wanna add to that?
I think an interesting thing about that is, one thing I noticed about Chicago is around town you'll notice, because we've spent so much time kind of understanding letter forms and what we're looking for and what in our own lettering, is you'll see vinyl that was like early vinyl when someone who was doing everything by hand kind of had to transfer over to the cutting system, and it's so much better if it's preserved in like an unlit, like a dark area where there's no direct sunlight. It's just like perfectly cut vinyl, which I think is an interesting kind of like juxtaposition to what is happening now. I mean, a lot of the work that we do too is, you know, we're full-time sign painters and gilders. You know, we work with designers all the time. So a lot of the images and designs that we produce are graphically made already. So it's just kind of, it's always a push and pull. There's always discussions. And on the one hand, you know, we're designers. And on the other hand, we're laborers. You know, that's what our job is. So it's, you know, as much as we want to kind of like, embolden what we do and make it really luxurious, we work really hard and we bust our asses.
Yeah.
We have to get, you know, we have to make a living wage and we have to pay for health insurance. So that's the world we live in.
I mean,
so
that's a huge different conversation, like art and labor and like policy. Let's not go there.
Yeah.
But yeah, at the same time, I feel like what I'm hearing you both saying, it seems like there have been the two renaissances, right? There's a renaissance in the 80s, which you, Robert, and Sean witnessed more of, and the renaissance today, where Andrew and Kelsey are more instrumental in kind of pushing that forward. But some of the questions that I can't help but have are like, you know, how do you, let's say I'm a landlord of a great building downtown that has this worn out sign, like to have to educate that mind to know that it would be of cultural value if you could have the original gold leaf gilding done to have that sign. There's that clientele that needs to be educated or reached out to. And then there's the other clientele, which is more of like, okay, we're talking about like, you know, mid-20s to early 40s, hipster, you know, we're all going towards the slow movement, culture, philosophy of like, we're going to start baking our bread again, but from scratch, we're going to be, you know, I have a little garden patch at the back of my house and I grow my own salad and, you know, it's, and now I'm opening a record store and maybe it would be nice if it had a gold leaf sign. You know, there's like a luxury to the slow movement that that is coming back. It's all on vogue again.
Those are our customers.
I wanted to make a comment about sort of what you're talking about is people don't, so I do a lot of probably like maybe 10 house addresses a day. Yeah, I wish. A year. I can do 10
And the next class would be from 9 to 11.
I can do it. And So I get reached out to these homeowners or property owners, and
they
have
year.
No idea, you know, what the price is. And, you know, I'll tell them, so four numbers are going to cost you $600. And they're like shocked. What? It's like, yeah, I'm there for 6 hours plus the gold, you know.
Real gold.
It's real gold. You know, so, I mean, it's nothing, it's no different than hiring a plumber, $85, $95 an hour, you know, it's no different. We're a trade, you know, we worked hard, so we're, you know, and I mean, there are people that get it, but there are some people that just don't get that. They think it's only $100. It's, oh, it should only be $100, you know.
I mean, there's always someone looking for a good bargain, okay? We can't stop that.
Oh, yeah. Right.
I'm Indian. Like, seriously.
Right, right.
But I feel like educating, what I mean is to educate, you know, the people who have that kind of economic right. mobility and understanding or like value for art and culture in a city like Chicago, which is culturally sure. vibrant. You know, what I'm just kind of trying to tease out, like, how do you, and I may be directing this more to Kelsey and Andrew because they are the next generation. How are you guys planning to, like, it's you versus the machines, man. Like, seriously. Like, seriously. It's
waiting for the singularity.
So how do you guys plan and the association, this association is one step in that direction, right? But how do you then begin to build awareness around?
That's a tough question.
Sorry.
Well, I mean, one thing, I think an important thing is understanding the value of your work and time and like having conversations with fellow sign makers about how we're all pricing, not, you know, we're all competitive with one another, but, you know, not undervaluing your work because ultimately that just cuts up it affects everybody. And I think a lot of people, there's lots of places that deal with that where, you know, there's problems in terms of like taking other people's clients and things like that. But
one of the things you also said to me before the talk is that, you know, once you have workshops and start educating another few people from the next generation, then you have more people practicing the craft. Well, I mean, practicing the craft, which also then makes it a little more affordable for your customers.
Yeah.
If you have more people in the job pool, you know, doing the work.
Yeah.
It makes it more Right. It can be a bane or a boon, right?
And Chicago's a really tricky place for this because there's so much bureaucracy and there's so many politics like around signs and then also labor. So it becomes a difficult place for this. But Andrew and I have been fortunate on a global scale. We recently were in Vietnam and we taught a gold leaf workshop there. And ironically have come into like a position where we're kind of, I wouldn't say mentors, but friends with people who are starting the craft there. And it's been really fascinating to see how they've taken this and just like push it really, really hard. And now they're just like there's a couple of students that we had in January and they're just like, every month there's like another sign they're making and they have all this confidence and they're really excited and people are excited there. And magazines are picking up on it and they're like, the local news is covering me and all this stuff. And it's just like, wow, this is crazy. So I think there is something to be said about like the effect of like, I guess maybe not. And I haven't really contemplated this outside of this stream of consciousness right now, but you know, like a local impact as well as like a global impact. And what does that mean?
I think it's fascinating. I mean, the fact that you're talking about gold leaf gilding, which was essentially an ancient like technique, which was also used amongst many other cultures like the French, etc. But Buddhist culture would gold leaf their deities and parts of the monasteries. And now here you are going back from like Midwest to like Vietnam and teaching them gold leaf. It's just like, it just shows you how we're pretty much in one small tiny pond together.
Well, I wanted to bring up W and B gold leaf because we have a representative here, but we did bring I'll let you explain W and B gold leaf, but W and B gold leaf is originally made in Chicago beginning in 1905. And we brought this product, still now American made, to Southeast Asia. And it's kind of one of those things where people were like really, really excited about the product because there is a difference in the leaf inherently.
What's the difference? Made. That's what I was actually.
And it's a lot thicker. So the leaf that is used for surface gilding on like Buddhist sculptures is very thin and transparent and wears away. There's a lot of inconsistencies. So for water gilding, which is what we do, it takes a lot more leaf.
Could you and just...
It's the best quality. Yeah.
Javier,
Urban, would you Urban, like to want to
jump in on the
quick plug for WNB.
Yeah,
this is
it's an important part of Chicago, yeah.
Yeah, we're the last company in the US that's still manufacturing gold leaf in the US instead of importing. Give you a little podium here.
You didn't need to have to give me this, I appreciate it. But we're the last company making gold leaf still in the US. We were exactly 100 years in Chicago, 05 to 05, and then we moved to Lake Zurich, a suburb, and now we're in Wisconsin. And actually right kitty corner here, they just tore down where one of our shops was for 50 years. We don't beat it as fast, we don't beat it as thin, and it makes for a more quality leaf. When it's beaten fast, it work hardens, it becomes brittle, has pinholes and more cracks and more unlikable holidays, you call them, in the leaf. So, yeah.
Is this something that, I mean, do you have other manufacturing centers across America? Is Chicago the only one?
In Wisconsin. In Wisconsin. And then we have people that do work for us in Chicagoland.
Okay.
But not, we don't have one facility anymore. People that work from home, actually.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, yeah. We really set up different during that last recession so we could exist still. Our biggest American competitor went out in 2006, Swift, which we were just talking about, out of Connecticut, and they didn't make it, and we changed how we work, which got us through that. But right now, because of especially young people getting into this and this renaissance of gilding coming back, we're grateful for it, but we can't find people to work for us right now. It's troubling. So
a lot of organization.
Right, right. Or people willing to learn. People willing to actually do physical labor, make a middle class income, and work though for it. Actually do something. Not, I don't mean that somebody sitting at a computer isn't doing something. I do that now actually, but right. You know.
But do you mind me asking how many people work for the company now?
We have 7 direct employees, and then we probably have another 14 1099 employees, people that are subcontractors that are self-employed, that work for us.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Wow.
I have a little story.
Thanks, Urban.
So when I met his grandfather years ago, when I first started gilding here in Chicago, and I was introduced, you'd have to go to the house on 80 Street, right? And he was very paranoid because he had gotten robbed a few times, so... You had to be introduced and call him prior to going to the house, and it was like buying drugs, basically. You know? And you had to have cash, you know, up front, you know. And you go to the door, knock, and, you know, little Mr. Bill Meyer come out, open the door and let you in the foyer only, right? And he'd go upstairs and get the pack of gold, and I'd hand him the money, you know. I actually had to hand the money before he even went upstairs, you know.
Really like buying drugs.
That's amazing. Are there also, I mean, I don't know where I read this, but are there like different kinds of leaf? Like there are different compositions and percentages that can be. So do you still have as much of a, let's say, palette to work with, or is that becoming more and more limited?
No.
Is that something?
Well, traditionally, the most common leaf that we use is the 23 karat double X for glass, and it's like the highest quality. Now it's instead of 24, you put something in there, right?
Yeah, 23 karat is 96% gold.
96.
Yeah, 3.5% silver and 0.5% copper.
That's it.
Yeah.
So that's the most common leaf. And then you have the 18 karat, which is a lemon. You have a 16, which is a pale. You have a 12 karat, which is white gold. Then you have your palladiums, you have your silver leaves, you have your compositions, your variegated, which is more of a copper that is fired, that has all the like patterns in it, you know, rainbows in it.
And I'm guessing the price varies.
Oh yeah, they all, of course, largely. They vary.
So in terms of like going back to my question again, you know, how do you develop clientele? You don't want the craft to die. You need to sustain it, which means you need to educate your publics to create clientele. And that's where I'm beginning, again, going back to like the younger question of how do you guys plan and maybe using the, like, how do we activate the association to be instrumental in this? Like, what are some of the things that you guys may be planning to do or offer?
This talk is a big thing for us. It's our first talk, if you can't tell. another thing is we're having a gold leaf workshop in June. So we're inviting people are coming from all over the United States, a couple people from overseas. So that's really exciting. I think there's tons of possibilities. I mean, I think, yeah.
Is it both lettering and like architectural things? Do you cover things? I grew up in Kansas City and they cover the entire dome of a church. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Gold leaf. It's called the Cathedral. It's in downtown. And that was in the early 60s. And it was spectacular and continues to be. But do churches and mosques and various places.
That's more of a decorator. More decorators do that. I've done a little bit of architectural gilding, but most of it is signage and lettering, you know, on glass.
Is it the same technique for covering
the building? No. You're actually more limited on a surface gild. You know, it's more using an oil size. And what we do on glass is more, you know, gelatin size in combination with oil sizes.
You get more of that mirrored finish. You get more of that mirrored finish when you put it behind glass and you use water as your medium, as opposed to oil, which is basically a paint that goes on the surface, a varnish, so to speak, which goes on the surface. And they both look brilliant, but if you look on Robert's sign over there, the real mirrored effect that you have is done with water and gelatin.
The only reason I was asking my earlier question is, I think, just to like be absolutely upfront about it is, you know, I think one of the questions at the forefront of a lot of our minds is, how much does craftsmanship matter anymore? And does it matter today?
It matters to us.
Yeah.
It matters to me. That's why we're all here. Yeah.
I think it's a really excellent question. And I think when it comes to signage, it very much dramatically changes depending on where you are. So in a place like Chicago, there is kind of a like stick with it, we're here to stay kind of attitude, and people are willing to put in the extra dollar to make it look like we're here to stay. And what says you're here to stay more than a gold leaf sign on your shop? It's classic. It is classic Chicago. It says, maybe I've only been here a year, but it looks like I've been here for 20, and I plan on being here for 50. In other places, people are going in just trying to make a quick buck. Places that are gentrifying fast, and they're coming in, they're not interested in that. They just want cheap vinyl signage. They don't plan on being there. So it is definitely it varies depending on where you are, the necessity of the craft that we offer, in my opinion, anyways. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I wanted to add something to that too. I think it has a lot to do with the entrepreneurships that we're seeing. it's the young people that are setting up tattoo shops and independent coffee houses and small little batch breweries, boutique things. They're trying to get away from that cookie cutter vinyl graphic that if you're a big company, a big corporate company, the corporation already has outlines on how your signage is to be done. So us craftspeople are out of that loop, you know? Our appeal is to independently minded businesses. Now, you know, we're not gonna be doing gold leaf signs on a laundromat or it's not for everybody. You know, the
hipster yes, that yeah, has beer as well.
Exactly. A Boost, yeah, Boost Mobile isn't gonna hire us to do gold leaf signs, but hipster laundromat, yeah, that would definitely. Yeah, we'd be all knocking on that person's door, right?
But one thing I did want to say is that I think we would be kind of like misguided if we didn't pay attention to the fact that there was a period of time where gold leaf signs were really valued. That died away. Yeah. It came back. It's going to die again.
Yeah,
postmodernism killed.
Yeah, hand painted signs. It's right now. It is kind of trendy, and I think that goes back to the question of like, how do we have these conversations? How do we talk about it? How do we educate people about that now, so that it isn't just a fad? It's a historical component to Chicago.
I feel like.
In the past, those trends could have been affected by depression or war.
Yes. Yeah. Postmodernism. You know, ornate things were considered bad.
Just the natural, like, you see a lot of it dies off, and it comes like the natural kind of ebb and flow, or is there other things people get tired of, or is it, you know?
Yeah, it goes out of favor. I think it runs its course, and then it, you know, it falls out of favor, and then they want something different, you know?
Yeah.
A couple of generations later, you know, it's rediscovered.
I mean,
yeah,
I think
maybe I have an overarching optimism, which is not a bad thing to have unless it ends up in horrifying failure or defeat, and then it's not so great. But I think with this last experiment, if we want to call it, from the, you know, mid 80s up until now, with the whole advent of the vinyl plotter, vinyl signage, all of the sign makers going for it, saying, I'm going to go broke if I don't start doing this. The whole craft died. Everyone just latched onto that technology. And we all saw what happened. It starts to crack. It starts to peel. It doesn't do the same thing that an old painted sign does. And I actually really don't like this phrase because it's kind of annoying to me, but I'm going to say it anyway. They say, paint ages, vinyl dies. I don't really like it, but it's kind of true. I don't like that phrase at all, but it's actually really poignant for this conversation at this point. I think we've run the course on what vinyl can do, and people are like, okay, we tried that. It was cheaper, it was faster, it was easier, but did it give us what we were looking for? And I think the answer is no. And I think now that there's a younger generation of folks who have seen that and they have an appreciation for an older style of things, I have an inclination that the hand-painted aesthetic, the gold leaf stuff, you know, maybe if there's a recession, the gold leaf could fall out. I don't see hand-painted signs going anywhere. I don't think people are gonna go back to like, oh, I want like super cheap, crappy signs for my like boutique coffee shop. I just don't see that happening anytime soon.
I completely agree with you, and I really appreciate like your just like volition behind this like mission. But like speaking to what Sean's talking about is that you're seeing it, you know, being applied a lot more to like entrepreneurial ventures and like small batch boutique. And that's speaking to like a cultural moment that like our generation is like embedded in. I mean, we're creating it and we're living it, but we're doing it in a very conscientious way to be like, okay, we've lived through the 80s and 90s, and now we see the value in things that were possibly, you know, forgotten for a minute and have like a significance to like deepen our cultural wealth and value as like a community. It's like, and that's where you're saying that some people who have, I don't even know if this is on. It's on? Okay. It's like some people who have, who've chosen to like commission you to do the gold leaf work as a sign of like landing presence in a community, or like saying, I'm invested in this, or I'm committed to this. And I like that analogy of like, what does that mean for the next generation that you know, we will age in the next decade, and how do we then, and that's what Kelsey, I think, wanted to speak to earlier as well, that like, you know, the transference of knowledge in a way that's more meaningful and more,
yeah. Well, I was going to kind of joke, like, we are always, Andrew and I are, oh, just like laughing, like one of our best friends in Chicago is a 60 something year old man, like I in a very good way. Like, I think that speaks to the fact that we have such a rich relationship with Robert.
I never acted my age, so
at Robert,
he's a 30 year old trapped in a 60 something year old's body.
That's the trick. As well as Sean, I mean, I think there's...
He's a 25-year-old trapped in a 50-something's body.
I think there's something to be said about, like, just having relationships with people and sharing something that you enjoy doing, and then being... I mean, when Robert says, I saw these gold leaf signs, I got the bug... Like, that was how I felt. I was like, I can't focus on anything else. Like, this is what I want to learn. This is what I want to do. And I did that for 6 years. And now, yeah, and I'm continuing to do it. Like, that's how I feel. So when you meet people who have that same sentiment and passion, irregardless of their background, that's valuable. But when you combine that with their previous wisdom, like, that's something... I think that's really special, and maybe sometimes we don't often have those relationships.
I think that's like, yeah, the nature of craft as well, yeah. Right? Like, you're speaking to what really is the essence of craft and craftsmanship, and that's that it's always been like something more than a verbal or like a cerebral engagement with a thing. It's more of like handling a material with your hands, mm-hmm. and sharing that experience with another human being builds a more fulfilling engagement, not just between two people, but then slowly within a community. Because if you do it with me, then, you know, I'll do it with someone else, and so on and so forth. Yeah. It builds this kind of more fulfilling communal living, which...
Yeah. I feel generationally, you know, the generations are different. You know, we're all different. But one thing, this is kind of a theory that I have, is that you tended to hate the immediate generation that preceded you. Yeah. You know what I mean? I grew up in the 60s and 70s. I grew up with the Starburst clocks and the Formica furniture and stuff like that. That's what I did. You know, I know you guys, young people, like postmodernism and mid-century modernism. Oh, I hate that crap. And you know, but I'd go to my grandparents' house, and they had all this cool carved Victorian furniture, and everything was, you know, oak with inlay and marble, and you know, and to me, that's what gold leaf kind of represents, is that unabashed opulence that you can that creates character, you know.
And your theory, I feel like your theory may also explain why it drops off every generation and comes back.
Yeah.
Because he just has to hate.
My son doesn't care a whit about what I do. So that's...
He's too close to you to see. That's why.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe that's it.
If you're too close to anything, there's no value for it. But yeah. Thank you for that. I think, that's a nice... There have been so many thoughts that we've shared, and I don't want to say, like, that's an ending note. So I'm just going to open it up to the floor. for any questions or just open conversation.
Yes.
I'm going to start this, and then I'm going to let either Robert or Sean finish it. And they can correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm merely a student of the gold. I am no master. There are in my mind, if you really distill it, at this time period, there were two distinctive styles of this type of opulent plate glass signage. One was coming out of the United States, and one was coming out of England. And the English style and the American style are, although if you look at them objectively, they seem pretty similar. If you really start to take a deeper look, the techniques are very different. There's a lot of different things happening, and I would say that is pretty much the binary. You have an English style and you have an American style, and I will hand it off to either one of these gentlemen who want to finish the story on that.
Okay. Well, I happen to like historic styles. Personally, I favor the English. I have a tendency in my work to have more of a European flair, because that's just personally what I like, you know. Not to take away from anything else, but I don't know. I find that historical styles in general, if somebody asks you to do something in an Art Deco flavor or in an Art Nouveau flavor or Victorian flavor, that I find compelling. I tend to like to design along those lines, you know.
But aren't there also, like, in terms of lettering and styles, there's like the Boston style and the Chicago style.
Oh, don't say the Boston style.
Don't say the B word. Don't say the B word. Are there different styles nationally?
Well,
no.
Like in America, within America, are there different styles?
Let's talk about the Chicago style.
Let's talk about this.
Well, let's let Robert
do her the favor of finishing the question that she asked. We're getting out on lots of tangents.
Yeah.
So as long as you guys don't agree.
Yeah.
Which you don't.
I do think that, like, in terms of when we go into, like, regionalism outside of England versus the United States, during that specific time period, I do think when we say Boston style versus Chicago style, I think that there were, like, specific techniques that were either refined or more economically used that can be appropriated to said region. And I think Chicago is historically pretty scrappy, and we kind of are a little more, I guess, associations with, like, mob history and things like that, like, you know, I think, yeah, leads in the Windy City leads into, like, how people use materials. So the Chicago style is a more economic approach than the Boston style.
The Boston style was made popular by a book called the Gold Leaf Technique Book by Raymond LeBlanc, that he wrote in 1951 or something like that, 1950s, early 50s. And he talks, and he's from the East Coast, so obviously he's going to talk about the Boston style, but it's kind of a controversy because we feel like it's the Chicago style is what he's mentioning and not the Boston style, because we don't see it in Boston. There's no style in Boston, you know?
You heard it here first. Boston has no style. Quote
Boston,
from Robert Frese.
No style. Cut the tape on that one.
I think they make beans or something, right?
But anyway, it's a long story, but it's kind of a thorn in the Chicago side, our side. Even the old timers used to. I've a friend of mine that's an old gilder still around. Balabusco, he's retired, but he was sort of a mentor too. I worked with him at F.O. Carlson years ago, a little older than me. And he even said the old timers used to be really peeved about the whole Boston versus the Chicago style. So, and it's still going on today.
Well, and that makes sense because as we said earlier before, Chicago was the glass decorating
Correct.
Capital of the entire nation. I mean, not even just in gold leaf, but even in stained glass. I mean, there
Correct.
Was a lot of there was a lot of work coming through Chicago, and it had a lot to do with European immigrants, exploited European immigrants, right? And that's that.
Yeah. Kind of,
in a roundabout way.
Everyone's been very eager to ask you technique and process-based questions,
right.
Which is also partially my weakness. It's just like, so I had a question about what the different kinds of metals, which you answered, but are there different techniques? Because you said something about using water in what you do. What is science versus others?
Okay, yeah, there's two ways to... Basically, two basic ways to apply gold leaf to a glass surface. And one is with a gelatin water size. So you basically cook sheet gelatin. They used to use capsules years ago. Still, some people use the old empty gelatin capsules.
Some people use Knox gelatin.
And some use that powder stuff, yeah, which is terrible.
You'd
it's
be
not,
surprised.
Yeah. But the best gelatin today is the sheet gelatin that you buy, you know, the cooking gelatin.
And WB, if you're interested, does sell it.
Yeah, right. He does. Yeah. So it's basically cooking gelatin in water, in purified water, and then apply. And once the gelatin, once you flood the glass with the gelatin water size, and then you lay the leaf on, and once it evaporates, it turns into a mirror. The gelatin holds the gold onto the glass, and it creates a mirror finish. The other size is an oil size, usually a synthetic, varnish, if you will. And there's a slow size, and then there's a quick size. Which is a 3-hour. It used to be the 3-hour and a 12-hour, but actually the quick size, the synthetic quick sizes are an hour, and you get a matte look with that, a matte finish. You don't get the mirror.
And you have to wait for the varnish to come to attack before
you. Yeah. So we incorporate both of those finishes in our work.
Doesn't it have to be flat or vertical?
No, we normally do it vertical. No, we don't normally do it flat. Because if you especially if you're water size and it's flat, it's never going to evaporate. You know, it's just going to pool there.
It's hard to do a storefront horizontally,
too. We're always doing storefront.
And
everything,
yeah.
No, because a lot of our stuff is on site. So, yeah. Like the pictures, if you go, the Fisher building, that's...
go back one.
These are some of my work. So anyway, for instance, the Victor Bar, which is a great place if you guys want a nice cocktail. That's great. And they're opening up a new one. I'll do a little commercial. It's called the Love Street. That's coming.
Yeah.
In about a month or so. So anyway, this one is a combination of, it's got the Chicago style. So we've got matte centers and we got convex. So we create a convex. And basically how I started with that job is you do the outlines first. It's all reverse, so it's all backwards. I'm painting all this backwards on the glass. So the first thing I do is the outlines, the black outlines. And then I go in with my my varnish, and I paint the where you see the highlights is the varnish. So I paint in the highlights and the matte centers.
And it's clear, so you can't really.
I use what they call a kaolin powder, which I dust. So it's you dust the glass with a kaolin, which causes like a film on it, a haze where you can see where the varnish is. Yeah, it's kind of tricky. And then after I usually wait. What we call line and juice. So I line and juice it the first day. Then I come back and then water gild the whole thing. I etch it and water gild. So I etch horizontally all that bright line, all the bright part. And then I water gild it, back it up, paint behind it. And then and because it's water soluble, the gelatin, it washes off wherever it wasn't backed up with the paint. And then the last thing would be obviously the shadow. I would incorporate the shadow, hand paint that at the very end. And then the last, after that, then you have to varnish it. We put a coat of spar varnish on it to protect it. That's pretty big. What'd you say?
I'd say
40 inches.
I would say it's 5.5 by 4.
It's big.
Yeah, that'd be my guess.
Big window.
Yeah. I would say, 5.5 by 4.
This is a door. This is a door for a shop. Do another slide, I guess.
He's making it sound really easy.
These are Sean's.
Real fast. In my personal opinion, whatever that's worth, I do think that Victor Bar piece is one of the finest gilded signs in all of Chicago. That thing is flawless. If you get a chance, it's on Damon and Irving Park. It is a great place to visit, but even if it's closed, it's worth going there just to look at the sign. I do think it is probably the finest guild in Chicago at this moment.
Chicago Guild Association drinks tomorrow, 9 p.m. Victor Bar.
Okay. Well, this is some of my work, and I'm... I do storefronts as well too, but I'm also trying to incorporate gold leaf signs as art as well as pieces that can be sold. That's what the early bird coffee is just the bird is hand painted. We got the Chicago style gilding on there. The background is then painted. It's all reversed on glass.
Can you point out the Chicago style gilding? You mean?
You see the coffee where right. the different varnish right. and effects are and everything.
Yeah, convex is a real Chicago style.
Yeah. On the Bella Rose tattoo, this particular client let me go hog wild with it, which is always nice. And I actually incorporate, you can kind of barely see it, but I incorporated some glass jewels in there. There is also some Hawaiian blue powa abalone shell within there, and we did some color blending. So again, like what Robert says, you start with the black outlines first, then I do the gilding, and then I do the hand painting behind that.
So. This also leans, I mean, this speaks to your background in like glass painting and other things.
Yes.
So this is like a technique that you have
kind
of created on your own.
You know?
So I was wondering, when you do this kind of blending, mm-hmm. as you see in the text, is that a mix of gold leaf and abalone, what you mentioned?
Well, the blending is different enamel paints.
Okay,
and we all have our own styles of blending. Some people blend with a sponge. Some people do a little stippling. I know Andrew and Kelsey, you guys like to add liquin to your paints to give it a little bit more flow and things like that.
Some people airbrush it.
There's, This is gonna sound really awful, but what we used to use.
Don't go there.
No, maybe I shouldn't go there. No, I don't. You sure?
All right.
We're all adults. What used to be great was a Kotex pad. Oh my God, it was great because you had the cotton behind that little film, and you could just.
We've all been to art school. We've all
stipple.
Done weird things. It's fine.
Yeah.
We all have memory.
Yeah, that's great for blending paint. especially red paint.
That's a second plug for the evening.
it's just another tool in the toolbox.
Kelsey, do you want to?
A guy like me gets funny looks
slide?
When I pull one out, but you know.
Are there any more questions in the audience before we wrap up? Is this your work?
Yeah, this is Kelsey.
Oh.
Yeah. This is ours. These are fun ones. These are ones where the clients let us just completely do our thing. So these are all done entirely by hand. The one on the left is a personal favorite of ours. It's a couple years old. It's not every day that your clients let you go kind of wild, like he was saying with the Bella Rose thing. So let's see if I can nail all the techniques on this. So we have 23 karat bright lines on the entire thing, and then we have Chicago style matte centers on Irving Park and Barbershop. And then it is a blended fade within them from 23 to 12 karat with 18 and 16 karat in between. And so that is carrying you down. If you look at the eye on the left, that's carrying you down from the top to the bottom there, and then also from the B as well. If you look at the B, you see some green in that little rosary or whatever you want to call it, the branch that the eagle is holding. That is tinted size. So we colorized the size on that one and then did that Chicago style. That's backed up with 12 karat. And then there are some color blends in the red scroll work there. That's all backed up. That's transparent, backed up with 12 karat. All of the scroll work that you see all around it is in 22 karat moon gold. The eagle itself has a red gold like chest crest. And then there is 23 and 18 karat feathers and wings on it. And then 18 karat legs and neck.
A very heavy bird.
And yeah, I think that.
Keep in mind.
Yeah, that.
Keep in mind, payment was just haircuts. Like
yeah, we traded this for three haircuts.
But I do think that we're nearing our ending point. So I do want to just kind of mention our collective, Chicago Gilders Collective. We have an Instagram, and that's kind of where we are right now. We're, you know, slowly building. If you have interest for more things, just like reach out to us. We have an email address. And finally, we would really like to thank Brad and the team here for
having us.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for coming out.